Priya.
Hi.
Hi, hi. So should we begin?
Totally. If you're ready, I am.
Yeah, we can begin. Okay. So this is a request to all the participants. Please put your questions in the chat box. We'll take them up at the end of the session. So our special guest today is Dr. Claire Colebrook. Good morning, Dr. Colebrook. And good morning and good evening to everyone attending this discussion from different parts of the world. So introducing Dr. Colebrook, she is Edwin Earle's past professor of English, philosophy and women's and gender studies at Penn State University. She has written books and articles on contemporary European philosophy, literary history, gender studies, queer theory, visual culture and feminist philosophy. Her most recent book is Twilight of the Anthropocene Idols, co-authored with Tom Cohen and Jay Hillis Miller. It's such a pleasure to finally have you here, Dr. Colebrook, on the screen. And thank you for agreeing to this interview immediately. It was such an amazing surprise. So our topic today is ecology, extinction, and posthumanism. And I think that our current pandemic condition is the most appropriate time to discuss issues related to environment and sustainability of humans as a species. So let us delve into the questions directly. Should we, Dr. Colebrook? We should start with the questions then? Yeah.
Okay. Sure. Go away.
Okay. So my first question, Dr. Colebrook, is how do you differentiate between personal is political and then the personal as geological?
Thanks. Okay, so the personal is political is a phrase I was brought up with and educated on. And it's a feminist phrase from Kate Millett. So the idea is that what you think your family relationships between men and women, by saying the personal is political, what Kate Millett and that generation of feminists wanted to do is to say that the domestic sphere actually is composed from broader political forces. So something like the history of patriarchy, that you don't have Western history without an original sexual contract between men and women. So that gives you the domestic space, that gives you reproduction, that gives you the family, that gives you the motor of Western history. But I wanted to expand that. And maybe I would change it from the personal is political to the personal is geopolitical. Because if you look at the private domestic space that feminists were talking about, the nuclear family, the bourgeois nuclear family, that's only possible because of a much longer history that includes slavery, colonization, the whole history of empire that colonizes certain peoples, enslaves certain peoples, enables then in the 18th century the private space of the nuclear family. So you can only have the private relationship between men, women in the liberal public sphere if you've had slavery from Greece onwards, right? The whole notion of the private subject was enabled by slavery. But then the whole European project of empire was enabled by colonization, indentured labor, and slavery. That transformed the planet too, right? So it was because of slavery and colonization that you had industrialization. It's because of industrialization that you are then eventually able to have abolition of slavery, right? And the extension of liberalism to more and more peoples. So to end this long and rambling answer, I would say you can't have the private individual, right? The personal, unless you've had a history that has transformed the planet and has transformed the relations between the West and its others, including the colonies, but including also the nations that contributed to slavery.
Right. So human history or natural history has always been interdependent, of course. So communicating through various modes of inscriptions, something which you write about continuously, the role of inscriptions. So have human inscriptions ever benefited nature in any form? Is perhaps
right, yeah. So one of the objections I often get whenever I talk or present my work is people saying to me, getting very upset because I speak as though humans have always been a bad thing. Like when I talk about the human and its destructive relation to the planet, there's two answers I would make to that. One is that every living being that contributes to the planet also transforms the planet in some way. There's always some sort of, let's use it, just a cost benefit analysis. But that's not very meaningful. When I talk about the human, I don't mean all human beings, right? Because the history of humanism and the history of talking about humanity has always excluded some humans, right? So in that respect, there's two answers to your question. The first is, has the human, in its narrow sense, in the sense defined by Western humanism and normative conceptions of humanity, that has tended to only benefit itself, right? What we are now looking at with this global pandemic is the cost of having created a global interconnected network, which means that we can't contain things like viral pandemics, but also viruses that leap from one species to another. So that's as a consequence of certain forms of intensive agriculture that were benefiting a very small portion of humanity at the expense of others. Now, if you want to ask, have humans in the broader sense ever contributed to nature? Not all forms of human existence are as destructive as the one that we now think is the privileged form of liberal humanity, which is high-consuming, urban, predominantly white, predominantly privileged humans. I just finished reading a book called Dark Emu by Bruce Pascoe about forms of Indigenous Australian agriculture that were sustainable for centuries before white invasion, right? That's just one example of forms of human existence that aren't at war with the planet and other humans. So first answer, you say, have humans ever benefited nature? In its narrow sense, humanity of the form of humanism we're now probably seeing in decline, not a great deal of benefit, right? I mean, some, you know, I have domestic dogs and cats, right? They're one of the good outcomes of that form of humanity. But there are other forms of human existence that are not at war with the planet, right? So when I think we're now talking about end of the world or end times, it's really the end of our world, right? A particular mode of world. And there are other forms of human existence that are possible that aren't necessarily at war with a nature that they seem to at once valorize, but also destroy in creating it.
Right. So do you think that in some way, restrictive meaning of violence is somewhere responsible for the climate crisis? That violence is usually seen as what humans do to, you know, other humans or human others.
Right. Yes.
And really to non-human others and natural resources. So is it a problem then?
Yeah. I mean, I think there's one way in which violence should be a human on human concept, simply because if you think about large scale or organized or systematized violence, in let's call it industrialized violence, right? There has to be a significant shift between you and I fighting over something, right? That's one form of violence, right? There's a a relationship between one body and another. But when I fight with you, not because of a dispute between us, but because of, let's say, I've been sent to war, right? Or I own a factory and I'm now extracting exploitative labor and you never even meet me, right? But you're now subject to violence from a human you have no relationship to. I would say that that form of systemic violence, right, needs to be distinguished from a, let's say, local violence. So local violence versus systemic violence. And then I would say that one needs to look at the way that systemic violence, let's say we take my two examples, I'm sent to war to kill someone I've never met, right, with whom I, or that I own a factory and every day of my life I'm subjecting you to a form of violence that you have no personal relationship to. We can always think that those forms of systemic human violence also have their cost on the planet, right? So I would hesitate to call it violence to the planet, right? Because unless you're of a certain way of thinking, the planet is not something that can feel, right, injury or harm or have a sense of justice. Now, an animal might, of course, right? An animal might feel it's being treated unjustly, and one could refer to that as a form of violence. But I think what needs to be thought about is the way human-on-human violence, I'll take, you know, from war, slavery, exploitative capitalism, have their cost on human bodies and the relationship those human bodies have to the planet, right? So the colonization of Australia not only damaged the planet, which we're seeing now in bushfires and so forth, but also was a violence upon Australia's Indigenous peoples, who possibly had a non-violent relationship to nature. So, yeah.
Right. So also, taking the cue from you about nature, so there is also always this false information that we are fed from childhood, our childhood days, about the abundance of nature, you know, that nature is not primary, that it's auto-generative, that it's not self-renewable. So what was the beginning of, you know, such a notion of nature?
Nature. Right. So one answer would be if you think of the Christian theological tradition, right? Be fruitful and multiply, right? And every creature great and small and God's abundant gifts. There's built in, not just in the biblical tradition, but more in the Christian pastoral tradition that follows, the idea of dominion theology. You know, God gave us the earth and it's our duty to make it abundant, right? So I think a notion of an ever-giving nature for us as privileged humans is built first within the Christian tradition, but then within the Christian pastoral, romantic, liberal tradition that increasingly has a notion of nature as infinite plenitude, right? Again, my one counterexample to that, and you might have other examples from different cultural backgrounds, is if you look at the Australian Indigenous tradition, there's not a notion of nature as infinite, right? There's a notion of nature as something, even if we want to call it nature, that one needs to have a conversation with, that one needs to have some form of respect, that it's not a resource, take it, you know, it's not, and it's certainly not infinite in its plenitude. You have to manage and give back and do things like move on from one plot of ground to another, be somewhat nomadic as opposed to thinking that this is an infinite supply chain. So I think that I would say that that notion of nature as an infinite resource is something that begins in the sort of Christian liberal tradition. But now when you think of late monopoly capitalism, it's become completely intense. Where I am in central Pennsylvania, you can buy tropical fruit all year round, right? There's a sense that everything is already available. And if it's not available, there's a sense that something has gone wrong, right? As opposed to things actually having some form of non-productivity at some point in their life.
Right. My next one is a bit more politically inclined, I think. So we do think about extinction, you know, like let's say you and I, when we are thinking of extinction, we are thinking in a sort of it as a sort of macro disaster, let's say.
Right.
So what, according to you, makes people so blind to this imminent outcome? So let's say, you know, so what I'm thinking is the existence of micro worlds or micro territories based on rise of nationalism, say in India or let's say in America. So and then yeah. Is it responsible for this, you know, micro thinking? Is it political unthinkability in some way?
Right. So I think what we're saying now, just to take the American example, is a weaponization of people's fragility. So that if people don't, I mean, in the US, and I'm not a, I mean, I'm a recent US citizen, right? So I probably grew up as you did with this notion of, you know, the greatness of the US, right? I was fed on all the television and myths about the US, right? Whereas it's actually a country that suffers from poverty, from lack of healthcare, from the sort of violence that follows from abandonment, right? And exposure and fragility. So you ask about sort of parochial nationalisms. If people are hungry, deprived of water, can't make it to the next meal, have to go into work in the midst of a global pandemic without any form of protection and they're massively exposed, of course, their concern is not for the planet and humanity, right? Of course, it is for a form of immediacy. That can take two forms. One, which is the reactionary form that you suggested, right? Which is that there becomes a immediate demand for greatness, make America great again, right? And a focus on getting back to work, getting back to productivity. And if you point out, well, actually these current lockdowns have given the planet a chance to breathe, someone who's very exposed and vulnerable can say, yeah, but you're a university professor, you're still getting paid while you teach from home. I can't work, I can't eat, I can't live, right? Just get me back to work and to hell with the planet. That's the bad form of it, right? That it's created these parochial nationalisms. A lot of the current disaster has resulted in anti-immigration, you know, a resurgence of racism, not just in America. Okay, America has, yes, become more enclosed, more parochial, but I understand from my friends in Australia the same thing has happened there, right? But there is a good outcome to this state of emergency, right? Which is the US has also seen, and again, worldwide, these Black Lives Matter protests, right? And to some extent, they are to also to do with fragility and exposure and immediacy, which is we may be at the end of the world. The climate may be falling apart. There may be no hope, right? We may be living in end times, but at least you could treat us decently, right, on the way out, right? So maybe there's no grand solution for climate change and world justice. But the phrase I would use is minimal ethics, you know, a minimal ethics of the Anthropocene, which is a book by Joanne Zielinska, which is, okay, we haven't got big macro solutions to extinction, but what we can have is fresh water, food, some form of economic justice, a redistribution away from the 1%, right? So even though climate change is obviously climate change and the Anthropocene are big issues, they don't displace and they can somehow intensify the smaller issues about social justice, which of course are interconnected, right? But so parochialism can take two forms, right? And I think it's had a good resurgence in these protests against white supremacy.
Right. Whatever humanity means now, so is a category so completely enmeshed in the Anthropocene that, let's say, imagining a human without, say, a nuclear bomb to protect their country would be an impossible task. So how do you propose a reshaping of this imagination?
Right. So I've written a lot about post-apocalyptic cinema, and I don't know, like, if you watch American cinema, right, the end of the world is always the end of New York or Los Angeles, right? And usually those films will pan to countries, often depending who's the enemy of the day, but China, and you'll see Shanghai and Beijing just being swept away, which is sort of disastrous, but it doesn't really, you know, it doesn't matter as much as long as the small pocket of Manhattan is changed. So when we talk about the end of humanity and the end of the world, we're often talking about a very limited and privileged conception of humanity. Invariably white, urban, usually American, sometimes London. And when we talk about the Anthropocene and the humans that have transformed the planet, it's those humans, right? It's not indigenous Australian humans who, you know, are hyper-consuming and destroying the planet. So your question, can you repurpose this concept of humanity? Yes, I think you can, right? I think there's, you know, in one of the many recent incidents of race violence in the US, a woman called the police on a black man who was bird watching and claimed he was attacking her. That was premised on the fact that if you call the police on a black man, chances are he'll get shot before. He didn't get shot. And after the incident said, I refuse to be dehumanized, right? So that's when the human becomes a polemical term, right? It's not about saving humanity or this is not who we are. It's about someone claiming humanity. So I feel like all the answers I'm giving you, there's always two sides, right? One is we need to rethink what counts as human. If it's the human that's at work when we talk about saving humanity, we tend to usually be talking about saving hyper-consuming humanity. But if we're talking about just saving something that we recognize as a life worth living, right? I refuse to be dehumanized. Then that counts as a different use of the term, right? It's a more open term. It's something that has a right to exist. And I just saw two interesting lines in chat. Someone was saying Spinozan trans individuality, right? Which is yes. So that it's not me and my humanity is this inviolable, right? It has more of a sense of something that we experience. The more human I am, the more human you are, right? It comes through mutual recognition. And then someone else said, or interobjectivity, right? As opposed to intersubjectivity, where I assume we're all the same. There might be, we're all connected, but we're unreadable. We're not subjects, right? So I think it's at least a term that really needs to be rethought as opposed to just saving humanity, you know.
Right. So talking of post-apocalyptic cinema, especially from Hollywood, so what do you think, you know, because we always find, you know, as people saving people or people saving one's own kind. So we keep saying that, you know, everyone must be saved for ecology to sustain itself. So why? What do you think it's symptomatic of that we keep saving ourselves?
Right. That's, I mean, I think there's two ways you can answer that. One, in Hollywood cinema, saving the world amounts to saving Manhattan. I think that has to do with a very specific form of American exceptionalism, right? If you are not born in America, you, as in you, were probably brought up watching British, American, Indian, you know, culture, right? At least more than one, at least more than your own culture. So you have a sense, yes, that you are who you are, right? But you also have a sense of people speaking English with different accents, right? Other modes of existence. I was brought up that way. You were brought up that way. I think Americans tend to be brought up watching America, right? With a much more narrow conception of the human. So I think Hollywood post-apocalyptic cinema does tend to think of saving the world as saving America, right? So that's a unique thing to Hollywood. However, I think your question is, you said saving one's own kind, right? It makes sense, right, that one that unless one lives a completely suicidal existence, which some beings can do, right, that we have a parochial interest in saving ourselves, right? We have a parochial interest in saving ourselves. That I might point out to you that the cost of you living is too much for the planet to bear, but it's very hard for you to say, okay, you know, my life is not the best, therefore I will myself to cease to be. So I think there's a parochial interest in saving one's own kind, right? I think what's interesting in the 21st century is that we are confronted, when I say we, some forms of humans are confronted with the cost of your own kind, right? And it's therefore, I think the question of an ecological ethics is one of recognizing one wants to save one's own kind, but there are other kinds that also want to save their own kind, right? As opposed to looking at forms of existence and saying they're not worthy, which is what Western imperialism has tended to do with the rest of the world, right? It looks at Mexico, Africa, other parts of the world as though those forms of existence aren't worth living and need to be brought just like us, right? And I think a lot would be gained by thinking other forms of existence seek to save their own kind, right? Someone has said in the comments, a politics of the more than human, right? There are forms of being that seek to preserve themselves that aren't just like us, right?
Right, and yet saving one's kind gets subverted when we think of, you know, let's say religious fundamentalism, suicide bombings.
For sure. Yeah. So that goes back to your question about violence. What is it that you would die for, right? Yeah. You know, what sort of violence would you commit either to yourself or another for something that you are not going to experience? Now, the interesting thing about that form of dying for something, you know, who would you kill and what would you do in order to save the world, right? Who would you kill and what would you do? And currently we make that decision every day, right? That particularly in the hyper-consuming West, everything we do has a knock-on effect that is probably going to do a harm to someone. So we can see things like the suicide bomber as exceptional, right? Someone who will kill themselves and kill others in order to save an idea that is, you know, supposedly transcendent. I would say that's an extreme form of everything we do every day of our lives, right? In order to save ourselves. And whereas the suicide bomber has one notion, right, of what's worth saving, and the hyper-consuming, affluent, urban individual has one conception of what's worth saving, an ecological ethics, right, in a time of extinction, asks about saving what is not oneself, right, and has to then ask those questions within what someone here has referred to as the more than human, right, because we're always making both some form, always asking others to make some form of sacrifice for our lives, right? And at some point there would be things that I'm assuming we would not do in order to save ourselves, right? And we need to see that that's an ecological ethics, that we're doing something like that every day of our lives, right? We're making decisions about what's worth saving and not worth saving. And it's always more than ourselves.
Right. So when you're saying, or when you keep saying and writing in your books about the possibility of human history after humans, so what kind of human are you referring to? So, I mean, who is your, or what is your post-extinction ecologist? You know, are you referring to creatures awaiting a later life?
Okay, so you and I are academics, right? We spend our day reading books and right now talking computers, right? And if someone tomorrow, and this is something I've been thinking a lot about because of living in America right now, if someone were to take this all away from us, right? You no longer have your books. We no longer have Zoom. We no longer have Facebooks. We no longer have intellectual conversation, right? We're left at the level of mere subsistence. You and I would probably feel that as a tragic loss, right? And probably think that life is not worth living, right? If I'm asking you to go from the life you live now to one where you're merely gathering food, you know, fending off the forces of destruction, fighting for water, right? We might think that's the end of the world and life's not worth living, right? But we know, you and I know, there are forms of human existence that have not had books, computers, Facebook, universities, and those forms of living have deemed themselves to be worth living, right? So again, it's when I argue for after humans, right? It might mean just after the types of humans you and I are, right? We're both different, but we do have this common, let's say, private reading, private thinking, subjectivity in its rich, you know, academic sense. We know there are forms of human existence that would look at what we do and think that it was a life not worth living, right?
Yeah.
And so, I mean, genuinely, right, we probably have students that think that our lives are a living hell. What? You're reading and writing all day? My God. So I'm suggesting we don't universalize, right, what we take to be a life. It's a life worth living for us. It has absolute value for us. But there are probably going to be forms of human existence that we don't recognize, right, that have our future, even if we don't.
So are you proposing a reshaping of man vis-a-vis the end of man?
Right. So, as you know, I do use the word man, end of man, right, even though, right. Because that's exactly what it has been, right? Let's call it what it is. It's been a privileging of man. The human is man in its usually white Western reasoning form. Yes, I'm saying that what we think of as a life worth living, what we think of as human existence, is but one possible mode of existence, right? It's nearly impossible from where we are to value for ourselves, right? For ourselves, other forms of existence. But that's because we have been composed from reading books, having academic conversations, social media, and so on. But that's one modality of the human, right? So the thought of extinction right now is to, I think, imagine other forms of existence, right, that don't do the violence, right, that you asked about earlier, that aren't reliant on one part of the world experiencing privilege while we outsource our violence and fragility elsewhere, right? So it's imagining other forms of human existence that sometimes have not been recognized as human.
Right. So you've always said this repeatedly, that man has always been post-human in an ultra-humanist way. So you keep saying, so, but isn't this what post-human advocates like, let's say, Bradotti or Haraway are against? So of course, they are extending human and therefore humanism, and you are ending them. Is it a sort of reconstruction you are saying?
So someone posted in the comments, in the chat, How far is it true in posthuman existence precedes essence, right? Existence. Yeah. So that's a line from Sartre. That's a really good comment, because my claim would be, when Sartre says that, you know, we have no essence, we create ourselves. Sartre says that in the 20th century, but for Western humanism, that's always been the case, right? Yeah. I am not a being that can be, I am always self-creating, right? That's the liberal Kantian tradition, but it goes back before that. So humanism, the history of humanism has always been, humans are not things, they're not, they can't be defined, they create themselves. Even in Aristotle, right, we are beings who narrate ourselves and give our lives form. So in that respect, that's what I mean by saying humanism has always been post-humanism, right? So when we see certain forms of humanism today, right, that are anti-essentialist or anti-biologist, right, that we are nothing other than what we make of ourselves, I would argue that is a form of humanism, right? That form of post-humanism is a form of humanism. And I would also argue that it's problematic, because this notion of I create myself, I give myself being, you know, I have no essence. If you look at where that's gone in the 21st century, it's a form of neoliberalism, right? You make yourself, you can buy yourself, you can refashion yourself. You are nothing other than what you decide to be. And it precludes all the different ways in which we don't have control over our being, right? Mm. And that would include race, gender, sexuality, you know, the all the ways in which I don't decide who I am, right? I can't just take on another race, right? To name one example, right? There are many ways in which that notion of self-creation has created an alibi for all the forms of ways in which certain things can't be recreated.
Right. So when you talk of a single pane of indifference, let's say, so where humans and non-human animals proliferate with independent claims and expressions, so are you specifically going against the interrelational existence, you know, a specific branch of posthumanism talks about, that there should be an interrelation?
Right. So as you know, yes, there's one form of posthumanism in which everything is interrelated, right? And what I try to suggest when I criticize that, of course, it's technically true, right? We live in a planet in which everything is interconnected. The minute I encounter another human being, we either speak a common language or we have a sense of language, right? There's, in one sense, there that interrelational thesis is trivially true, right? What I want to suggest by non-relationality is all the ways in which the geopolitical system creates one form of interconnectedness, which is, let's call it global capital, neoliberal global capital, but that there are some forms of difference it cannot recognize or bear any relationship to, right? So forms of value or forms of existence that aren't recognized, right? And don't want to be recognized, right? Don't want to be included within like a general global humanism. And some forms of existence that we cannot recognize, right? That towards which we bear no relation, and that should be seen as somehow refusing recognition or understanding. When there are claims for sovereignty from Indigenous peoples, that's often a refusal of relation, right? I don't want to be included in your country. You know, we want to make a separate claim, right? That has a certain form of autonomy that's not recognized within your own political system.
Right. So for you personally speaking, does posthumanism have no other, you know, have no other value, let's say, except acting as a reference point, except, let's say, as hyper-Cartesianism,
or right,
facing threats of non-being, where man is nothing other than becoming?
So I'm just also looking at the lines from the chat. So, I mean, when you say, does posthumanism have a value? Of course, it's such a broad term, right? And what counts as posthumanism? There are some versions, and someone in the comment said we have, you know, a lot to learn from feminist, indigenous, you know, queer, black speculative fiction, things like that. I think those forms of posthumanism that try to refashion what would count as a recognizable mode of existence, of course they have incredible value in the present. Someone mentioned, you know, Octavia Butler, Ursula Le Guin. I'm currently reading or rereading the work of a contemporary American writer, N.K. Jemisin, who writes about a world in which we relate to each other through the vibrations of the planet, through stone, right? So that what counts as being human is not a human-on-human liberal public sphere, but a connectedness through the earth, feeling the vibrations of the earth. That form of posthumanism, right, where there's a different form of relationality, right? It's not human on human, as you said, Cartesian subjective relatedness, but a sense of relationship to each other through the earth, right, through the common myths and vibrations we share about the planet. That form of posthumanism is, of course, the only way in which we're going to have a future, right, is to have some perception of the other than human. However, the form of posthumanism that, let's say, someone like Nick Bostrom at Oxford's Future of Humanity Institute, which is, you know, we can manufacture and refashion ourselves, we can use artificial intelligence and technology to live forever. I mean, they're actually arguing, like right now, this institute at Oxford, arguing that we should be working out how to live forever, you and me, live forever, right? We can't, I mean, that's, to me, that's like not recognizing the planet. That's not, comes from not recognizing the planet or other individuals. So someone's just said, does a post-extinction world constitute a fundamental form of living and becoming? And so that's what I'm arguing for, yes, right? That if we can imagine that we don't live forever, right? That's the first, get rid of that form of post-humanism. If we get rid of the idea that I can constantly supplement, augment, transform myself, right, to be stronger and stronger and more robust, that form of posthumanism, no, the Ray Kurzweil form of singularity. But forms that ask us to live with a sense of our own fragility and finitude in relation to the planet, yes, that, and so as someone said in the comments, those are the forms of Black, Indigenous, queer, speculative posthumanism that are the opposite, right, of the Nick Bostrom form of posthumanism as infinite transformation and technological enhancement.
Right. So is this the point where you break off from, let's say, posthumanism and enter the critical study of life?
Right. Okay. So you're mentioning, yeah, critical life studies. What my colleagues, Jamie Weinstein and Myra Heard, tried to do with critical life studies is shift the notion of life. You mentioned in one of your earlier questions, this notion of nature as infinitely abundant, creative, you know, proliferating, endless. We thought when we launched this notion of critical life studies that we tended to think of life in this neo-Christian form of infinitely creative, infinitely abundant, infinitely proliferating, that it was a sort of post-romantic notion of life. And what we wanted to do was look at other conceptions of life that are non-continuous, destructive, fragile, at war with themselves, right? Again, going back to some of the comments about speculative post-humanism, Jemison writes of a world in which the power to create and transform is built in with destruction and loss, right? So that form of life, a critical form of life in which not everything is proliferation, becoming vitalism, vibrancy, right? In which one recognizes the destruction, the violence, the loss, the fragility, the vulnerability of life, right? That's a very non-Western Christian understanding of life, right? So I would be critical of the simple valorization of life or vibrant materialism that you get in some forms of vitalism, for want of a better word, yeah.
Right. So I find it very interesting. Also, you said it a while ago, that there's always this residual humanity which is left behind in or fought for in post-apocalyptic novels or films that you call, yeah, ultra-humanism, of course. It triumphs. Yes. So my question specifically is, so do we learn anything from the current pandemic then? You know, is it the time to engage in speculative realism or as an ecological being?
I mean, we learn a lot from this pandemic, right? We learn that the things that are most essential, right, when we pare down to essential, are the things that we pay the least for, right? So it's not just a feature of America, right? But the people that have kept working, food workers, health workers, right, transport workers, these are the people that are at the most vulnerable, the most exposed, right? The least privileged with this proliferative a nature. The other thing we've learned about that the pandemic has taught us, and I'm sure, I mean, it really has taught us, is that things change, right? I mean, that there is life does not necessarily go on the way it has before. So I think this is the beginning of a genuine sense of extinction, right? That things end, right? That things might end. The other thing, and I'd be interested in people like commenting or giving feedback on this, is most humans have lived with a sense of global catastrophe. Most humans have at some point lived with a sense of global catastrophe. Unless you were born, let's say in the US, after World War II and you died last year, right? Like after World War II and you died last year, but even then you've got things like the Cuban Missile Crisis and Rwandan genocide, right? This is for my generation, a seemingly unprecedented global catastrophe, right? But at some point in someone's life, this is the norm, right? That the world you know, the interconnectedness you know, the continuity of the world you have can suddenly be exposed as possibly extinct, right? So that the example, you know, that Heidegger has, that I only know I have a world, right? When I'm typing on my computer, suddenly my computer crashes and I realize that my world is composed from this computer. Heidegger had that with everyday objects, right? Your world breaks down when your hammer breaks. He was right and he was wrong. Where he was wrong is it's not the small things, right? At some point, something like a global pandemic, but we can think of World War II, right? Or even maybe for many peoples outside the West, there have been, you know, near extinction events all the time, right? So that what one might want to say about extinction is, yes, it is something of our time, the 21st century. We have a particular form of it, which would be climate change. But probably that global catastrophic sense that your world might end is probably a far more common human experience, right? That a certain generation has been sheltered from. I can't think of, if you look at history and geopolitics, I can't think of many humans who would not have experienced some form of global catastrophic near extinction event. People could give me counterexamples, but I think it's probably, you know, one of those rare universal experiences.
Right. So is this the point again where you know, let's say shift from post-humanism to posthumous existence or posthumous?
Right. So, yeah, we, again, in the book I wrote with Jamie and Myra, Jamie Weinstein, Myra Hurd, we came up with the concept of posthumous existence, right? And we wanted to have that to have a couple of senses. Obviously, the first sense is posthumous, living after you've died, right? And what it might mean to say goodbye to a certain form of humanism, right, including posthumanism, and live with it in a manner that is somewhat mournful. So instead of having films and books about saving the world, right, we might start to think about saying goodbye to the world we have, right? Learning to distance ourselves from ourselves, not be so concerned about saving us, to go back to your earlier comment. That's the first sense of posthumous, right? Recognizing in the era of the Anthropocene that a certain conception of the human has to be over, right? And that one has to live after one's own kind. The second sense of posthumous is, of course, humans, the word human, humus, from the earth, right? That comes from that Adamic myth, is maybe living with a sense that we are living after the earth, right? We no longer have a right to the earth, right? The earth is no longer ours, right? We are its cohabitants rather than its owners. So that sense of posthumous, after the earth, right? But then there's a third sense of posthumous, which is rethinking the concept of the earth itself, right? After the notion of the earth as humus, fertile soil, right? That the earth is also something that lives and dies and breathes and has a limit and has its own forms of internal violence, right? That we're probably not owners of the earth, but we've probably been at war with the earth to a certain extent. So yeah, that's what we were trying to get at with posthumous.
Right. So in your extinction theory, are you somewhere advocating then that the death of institutionalized theory in humanities is and otherwise, and a vehement focus onto praxis, the death of theory and then, you know,
yeah,
going to praxis more? Is it what you're suggesting?
I mean, it's hard to suggest that for me, right? Because you and I are theoretical animals, right? So it's in some ways hypocritical for me to read and write all this theory and then ask about its end and say, oh, but it doesn't matter, it's its end. That leaves us with what I think is the paradox, which is we value our own kind. We want to save ourselves, and that includes saving books and saving theory, right? And one does that, but from within that, one also needs to look outside at things other than one's kind, right? I go back to some of the comments in the panel. People mentioning speculative fiction, right? New forms of writing, new forms of theory. It's always the case that theoretical life, the life of art, lives on only by destroying itself, right? We can't just keep doing the same stuff. So there's a negotiation between living on, right, doing what we do, and recognizing that there are certain parts of us eventually that won't live on, and then nothing will be there, right? And that's okay, right? It's this attachment to living on, preserving. You asked about forms of inscription, of keeping something that's there forever, right? That has to be said goodbye to, dismissed, abandoned. You know, that's what I think about as a post-extinction ethics, is one in which one can live with the idea of not living on.
So, I know I'm repeating myself, but I'm really intrigued by, you know, your notion of the afterman, and specifically not post-human, but let's say after-human. And in a very, strange way, reminds me of Godot, you know, the Godot as the afterman who is supposed to come and to read the signs,
right,
waiting, but never comes, you know. So is your afterman a metaphor, a mere metaphor, or...
Right, you know? Right. So, yes. In some ways, yes, right, that there's always been a sense, when we talk about humanity and saving humanity and the human and humanism, we never mean humans as they actually are. Every conception of humanism is what we would be, what we could be, right, what we ideally are. Whenever there are events of torture, these are called crimes against humanity. As though humanity isn't torture, and it shouldn't be, right? It isn't mass murder. It isn't genocide. These are crimes against humanity, even though they're what humanity does. So there's always been, within the tradition of humanism, a condemnation of actual humanity and a valorization of this virtual humanity. When we talk about saving humanity, we don't mean saving slavery, colonization, exploitative capitalism. We mean saving something that does not yet exist, right? So that virtual or after human is built in within the human tradition. So what you're saying, is it a metaphor? In that sense, it always has been, right? Humanity has always been a figure or a metaphor or an ideal. But there's another way to look at the after human or after man. And that's not as this ideal of what we properly are or what we should be or what we could be if we just clean things up a bit, but something that abandons that notion of a proper humanity that is lying just in wait, right? As long as if we clear up the accidents of like war, slavery, indentured labor, colonization, those things that happen to have sullied them. If we recognize that they're within humanity, then there's something about saying goodbye to that progressive, rational, cosmopolitan tradition.
Right. So what is, according to you, the ethical way of imagining extinction? So should it be a total annihilation through nuclear warfare or slow progressive elimination, let's say through a pandemic?
Yeah. Let's say this. I would say that an ethics after extinction is this, that using the term problematically, we humans cannot be saved, right? One thing we know is that what calls itself humanity, let's say global capitalism that relies upon the private sphere of hyperconsumption, right? Global liberal capitalism that relies upon the private sphere of hyperconsumption, that cannot continue. It is destined to end, right? It's a question of not when, not if, but how, you know, how bad, right? At some point that has to end, maybe sooner, maybe later, right? We are all aware, or should be aware, that private domestic sphere hyperconsumption has to end. How do we live knowing that, right? And I would say two things. One is to imagine other forms of existence. That's the speculative version of it, right? That has a broader, you know, Anthropocene ethics to it, right? Imagine other forms of existence. Start to recognize other ways of being human. But there's also a sense at which we know we can't be sustainable. We know this can't go on. How well can we behave in end times, right? Knowing that this is the end, do you want to steal everything for yourself and live large, right, in the last days, which is what we're seeing, right? We're seeing in corporate America a massive grab of resources, right, and a massive shift of wealth to the more and more privileged, right? Is that how we want to see things out? Or do we want to have a minimal ethics, right, where we stop Black people in America being killed for no reason, right? We allow everyone to have drinking water. We, you know, have some form of distributed healthcare, right? So there's one sense in which it can't be saved as a whole, but if it can't be saved, let's live out the end days. You know, how would you like to live your last days, right? Grabbing everything for yourself or having some form of ethics of distribution. So one form of post-extinction ethics is not the Naomi Klein version. This is an opportunity for us all to get everything. That can't happen, right? This is an opportunity for us to live better, right? Knowing that we're unsustainable. What's the best way to live with that fact?
Right. So here's my last question. So do you think that COVID-19 has offered us a chance to reimagine our extinction? So what are we to learn from this? Because this is clearly a case of the animal leaving an imprint on and in the human.
Sure. Yeah.
So what I'm asking is, once we do realize this urgency and emergency, what should our next step be?
Right. So if you think that the global pandemic, right, has revealed how destructive the current global capitalist system is, in that there's massive inequity in who dies, right? There's massive inequity who's bearing the economic cost of this, right? So it's an exposure of massive inequity. One thing it might have shown us is, which I think is part of the economic panic, is we actually don't need to be buying all the stuff and doing all the stuff we do, right? Air travel has ground to a halt. We're still okay, right? Hyperconsumption has ground to a halt. We're still okay, right? That's my dog barking in the background. So the other thing the global pandemic, has taught. So that's a sort of positive sense of what we're learning, right? The dependence the hyperconsuming world has on what we've called essential workers, the poorly paid, the most vulnerable, right? It has shown us, because of that exposure also of injustice, it's shown us that the world can change, right? There's not much that's positive in America right now, but one of the amazing things that's happened in the wake of these Black Lives Matter protests, the discourse of white supremacy has shifted dramatically, even cynically, right? There's all these corporations issuing these, you know, we think Black Lives Matter. Of course, that's hypocrisy, but at least it's the right sort of hypocrisy, right? So that the discourse around valuing life, right, in a pandemic has changed, right? So that would probably be the number one practical outcome of this, is valuing life, right? Because there's been like discourse about, oh, it's only old people that die, right? They're prepared, you know, in the US, they're prepared to sacrifice their lives for the sake of economy. Well, no, they're not, right? So we've started to pay attention to saving life, preserving life, recognizing the vulnerability of some lives, right? The pandemic in the US has exposed massive racial inequity, right? In terms of who dies, who gets exposed, who gets bailed out. And the thing is, that exposure of inequity is not going unnoticed, right? That's, for me, that's one of the positive things. There's not much to feel positive about in Trump's America, but the fact that racial inequity has been, you know, once again, it's like the 60s all over again. It's got incredibly bad, but by the same token, it's become incredibly apparent, right? And it is now a political issue. Yeah.
So can we take the questions now? 5 or 6 questions, maybe? Yeah. So I'll just shorten the questions. I think one is from Swati Lekha Maiti, who is saying, can we think about going beyond the essentially androcentric parameter?
Yes. I mean, short answer, yes. And it's interesting to say androcentric. So when I've been saying, you know, human-ocentric or anthropocentric, yes, of course, it's gendered as well, right? Which brings us back to your first comment about the personal is political. I think, yes, it's gendered. So going beyond man, right, means going beyond a world in which there's a domestic sphere of reproduction, right? Because one of the other things that's come out on the through the global pandemic is not just racial inequity, but also gender inequity. I tend to play down gender inequity, not because I don't think it's important, but because it's always so bound up with racial and geopolitical inequity, right? So that it's that the production of the domestic sphere and sexual inequity is the result of the production of man, right? So that question going beyond androcentric is giving up a privileging of man, which is a privileging of the autonomous, self-making, isolated, somewhat disembodied thinking subject.
So Nikhil Parveen asks, is there any way to trace human subjectivity in the post-human turn, or is there any possibility of having human subjectivity now?
Right. So I think the answer has to be yes, right? I'm against using the language of subjectivity, right? Because I see it as tied to a specific philosophical tradition where the subject is interiority. And if we look at how interiority gets produced, it's usually through institutions of privacy, right? Descartes can write his Meditations because he's isolated, privileged, alone, living in, you know, a private dwelling. So my tendency is to abandon the language of subjectivity. However, there's always a twin-pronged attack, right? Where, as I said before, some of the language of racial justice has taken the form of, I refuse to be dehumanized, right? I am a subject, not an object. When it takes that challenging or questioning or contestatory form, then I think there's still something we can gather from the language of human subjectivity. When it's directly politicized in that way, I refuse to be dehumanized. I think, you know, I am a human being. When it's a challenge or a provocation, it's a worthwhile concept. When it's simply normative, right? Saving humanity, that's inhuman, right? That's not who we are. That form of normativity, it's a bankrupt notion because it's trying to hold on to what we are when what we are is not just not sustainable and not sustainable, right? And not ethical.
So I think it's related, but Ravinder Singh asks, is human subjectivity to be replaced by interobjectivity then?
Right. I love that, right? I love interobjectivity. I love it because intersubjectivity is, I assume that deep down you're just like me, right? That's about recognition. You know, whatever differences we have, we're still subjects. We're still speaking. That implies a commonality or relationality that perhaps ought to be questioned. I love that term interobjectivity because it implies somehow you're unreadable, right? I don't know what you are, right? And imagine if I treated you well, not because deep down you're just like me, right? How, you know, deep down you're just like me. What if I treated you well because I wasn't sure, right? Is this a subject, right? Is this a subject or an object? Is it human or inhuman? What about I don't know, right? And I treat you well, without presumption of sameness, right? If the white settlers who arrived in Australia looked at the Australian Aborigines and said they're not human, right? So this isn't occupied. But what if instead of just saying, like, we don't know who these beings are, right? We cannot read or translate who these beings are. Therefore, there should be some form of respect, right? So I love that term, interobjectivity, which I might steal and probably footnote. So thank you.
This comes very close to what Zizek says about, you know, detachment, you know, that your neighbor right. should be disturbed. Make yeah.
Yes, I mean, there's a lot one doesn't want to celebrate in Zizek, right? Yeah. But you're right that because Freud, you know, and Zizek gets that from Freud, right? Love your neighbor, love your neighbor, love your neighbor. I'm supposed to feel love for you, right? And Freud says, if I'm asked to love you, I might just like, no, I don't love you, right? That's too much to ask of me, right? To love you. But maybe instead of love thy neighbor, maybe I don't recognize you, you know, I don't like the smell of your food. I don't like the way you look. I don't like the way you talk, but I will be decent anyway. Right? Minimal decency. I'm not. So if we're asking people to love each other, right? That's trying to put it at the level of feeling. But what if we have no feelings of sympathy, empathy, or recognition, and we could still leave open a space for decency, right? So I think that's a really good, like, post-extinction, post-human ethic.
Right. So Nabunita Karanjai asks, can this model of subjectivity in the ecological sphere be rhizomatic, as Delusion Gattari put it?
Right. So maybe that's best. I mean, yes, right? Short answer, yes. And as someone's, the rhizome is not you and I are connected because we're human, right? The rhizome is a connection without that mediation. So it goes in all directions, right? You and I are connected now because we are speaking an academic language, right? That academic language branches out to all these people that have joined, but there are other forms of connectedness you and I don't share, right? By virtue of the fact that you live where you live, I where you live. So I think the great thing about that rhizomatic is forms of connectedness are bound up with forms of disconnectedness. They branch out, they stop, they branch out in another direction, so that there's not a we're all in this together because we're human ethic, right? It's we're all in this and not in this together. We're connected but not connected. There are forms of violence and privilege, you know, I don't know, other people don't know, right? And it's rhizomatic means not presuming the ground for connection. So anthropologists assume the ground for connection is we're all variants of the human. The rhizomatic is I don't know yet what relation or connectedness we have. So it puts relations and connections as a question, not a foundation. So yes. To the rhizome comment.
Yeah, so our last question from Swati Lekha Maithi again. So she asks, in future, what notion or views posthumanism may have towards the interspecies coexistence and ecological system in a macro sense?
Right. So I think the ecological component of posthumanism is probably the most important, but probably the hardest to assimilate, right? Which is, of course, for you and I, human existence has more value than the existence, or maybe, right, of non-humans. But I'll refer to someone like Patricia McCormack's work, who says there's nothing, right, nothing valuable about human existence, right? The world would be better if we would not be. I don't think we have to necessarily agree with that, but we do have to contemplate it, right? So I'm not saying we all necessarily have to turn off the computer and then go into some mass extinction project, right? But I do think as an ethical presumption, right, there would be some form of human existence that did not presume that it had a right to life, right? That the question of other lives, other humans, but also the animals and plants and everything we exist with, right? For itself has its absolute right to life, right? If some aliens came down from another planet and said, we're more intelligent than you and we've got better technology than you, therefore we're going to eat you, we would think that was a violation, right? We're better than you. We have better technology. We're smarter. We're going to eat you, right? That's what I think a posthuman asks us to think that way about the animals we eat, right, and the things we consume. That from their point of view, our intelligence and our technology does not give us that right.
Right. Okay. Yeah. So thank you so much, Dr. Colebrook, for your enthralling on the human condition, on environment, animals, and our survival on Earth as a whole. So I hope we'll have such sessions with you again in the near future. And thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank
have
you.
Have a good evening.
Patient and cooperative. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Colebrook.
Okay. Have a good evening. Bye.
Bye-bye. Yeah.